those things that are going on, to have you guys on, things we're doing. I ask you to plug in with us, and we're just going to keep on an unofficial partnership and doing what we can do to help each other. Folks, I'm going to take a short break. Ivan, give me a signal through John or somebody if we're ready. Okay, my main man. Okay, we're going to have to take a short break. I'm going to let these folks go, and I got some interesting things I want to talk about. Wilmington Housing Authority and Senator Chris Coons. Don't touch that dial. We'll be right back. God bless.
Osborne's Auto Repair, serving downtown Wilmington for 30 years. Delaware State certified in auto emissions. We do tune-ups, brakes, air conditioning, all car needs. Stop in and see Ed Osborne or his son, Ed Osborne Jr. That's Osborne's Auto Repair, 658-0377, or visit us on the web at osbornsauto.com. Stop in and see Osborne's.
Billboard campaign in the city of Wilmington promoting a confidential telephone number 888-1800 to help stop the violence in Wilmington sincerely needs your help. This anonymous call will not show your name or telephone number, so be a part of it all. Make the call to report any information that may solve a violent crime or prevent one. Remember, we are all in this together. Help our residents feel safe again in their homes and in their communities. Help to get the illegal guns off our city streets. Innocent people are getting shot and killed. Who will be next? Make the call. 888-1800. Sponsored by the Kingcenter.
Okay, back for the final portion of the program, and hope you enjoyed that first segment with my guests, and I look forward to working very closely with them, Kingcenter staff, and any resource that we may have to make sure as they bounce around the city, trying to really spread love, the chain of prayer. It's a good thing. It's a good thing. And as a result, you know, as Ms. Guy said, the violence has subsided drastically, very few shootings and homicides since the first of the year. And that's a good thing. And all that's being done, every bit of it, and prayers going up, and the prayer chain all in and around the city, I contribute each and every bit of it as being extra plus. But anyway, let me move on and over here to this other mic, John. I can hear this headset coming through. Just turn it down over there for me, please. Thanks. As you guys are talking, let me just say also as I move right along that This program will be placed hopefully tomorrow, no later than Tuesday, on YouTube so that you can see this program back if one wants to check it out to understand my comments. I'm going to make some important comments, very important comments in just a few minutes in reference to the Chris Coons issue, Senator Chris Coons. But before going there, I want to encourage all of those that are living in the public housing high rises, Compton, Baynard, what's the other one? Hurley, Crestview, there's another. But anyway, the elections are coming up for you to re-elect or reconfirm, elect new resident councils. And I was sent some notices from the main office informing me that all of these are coming up. I knew about Baynard because I've been working with Baynard closely after going to some meetings and whatnot, and Pauline Addison is working very closely with them. So that's how I knew about Baynard, but I didn't know the others were coming up, and they all were having their elections in April, different dates for the most part. I want to encourage each and every one of you in the high rises to please make every effort to be a part of your meetings, be a part of this election that you're going to have, check and see what's going on. And at the very same time, get involved with your resident council. Your apartment in one of those buildings is your home. That's your house in a sense. That's your home. And be it ever so humble, no place like home, as they say. And the bottom line is that you need to be working together in a very positive way with your councils, with the management, with WHA officials or whatever, and even us, the board, if you feel you need to come and bring it to us, to make sure that you're having the best quality of life. Aubin, I can hear you out here, man. Turn that thing down or off, man. Turn that thing off. I'm still hearing it coming through. Unplug it or something. Anyway, I'm sitting here hearing them. They're having a conversation in the control room. I'm hearing it come through on this other camera. But anyway, having said that, I know we got problems and connections and things out of whack. So we're going to work through this stuff that we're going to get it right and get it tight. But again, I want to encourage each and every one of you to participate in those elections. If you can, go down when they have those elections in your community rooms. Get involved. Don't just sit back and complain about what's not right and somebody need to do something about this. Those are your homes. And if you're organized and doing these things and approach them in the right way, you're going to get a meaningful and a positive result. And we, the board, stand by our staff that wants to do. We stand by you who want to bring things to us if you feel it's not being done at staff level. That's what the Board of Commissioners meetings are for, if you want to come and address the board. Go through the right chain of command. If you got problems in your units, write up, get someone to help you. Go through the resident council. Take someone with you to go down and talk to the manager, assistant manager, and turn in a incident report, put it on record. So many times that's what does not happen. And as a result, it ends up with a lot of he said, she said, trying to get to the bottom of a situation. And a lot of times, some of these situations are long gone and could have been prevented, and sometimes are even serious. So use those incident reports and work through your council. If you have a problem filling it out or whatever, but you got a problem in your unit, talk to your president or vice president or the complaints person of your council. But let's try to make this system work. And the same thing for you folks out in the family units or the low rises, Kennedy, Evans, or wherever you, Kennedy and, is it Evans? Up on 31st and Tattnall. Anyway, the family units, Riverside, Scattersite, Southbridge, all of you have the same responsibility to make sure that you're having the best quality of life that you can. For you and your family, those are your homes, long as you pay your rent and live up to the letter of your lease. So we're there for you. The new board, we stand by you. We're with you. Take it to staff. Do it up the chain of command. Turn in the incident reports And then if there's a breakdown and things aren't happening, I'd like to know about it. Come to the board meeting or give me a call. Call other board members. You know who they are, a lot of you. And they'll get it to us at the commissioner level, and we'll try to get it taken care of, okay? Having said that, over the last week and a half, there has been a lot of discussion in our community concerning Senator Chris Coons, our junior senator. And on last week, I had a lot on my mind. I come running in, and I thought to make mention, but I didn't get into it because time ran out as I was dealing with other things over the airways. Let me say to you, first of all of you sitting out there, and again, this will be placed on YouTube if, in fact, the dub is going to be proper and comes out in the control room as I'm recording this program on a DVD, as I do every Sunday. I've had some where I've kind of come out almost upside down and a bunch of craziness, but it's the equipment and all that. And anyway, the content was so good. It happened when I had Mayor Dennis P. Williams on with me. But the content and the dialogue we had was so good that I wanted to get that message out, and I did put it on YouTube. So if you go on YouTube and you see a couple of them look a little crazy for a few minutes or whatever, don't get hung up on it. Just listen to the content of the dialogue and what's being discussed, because that's the most important piece, as Al Plant used to say, because he uses thus and so and this and that. The bottom line is, the content of what he was talking about, the late Al Plant. Okay, having said that, let me share with you my view, my concerns of the Senator Chris Coons topic of discussion that has a lot of people up in arms. First of all, let me say that I stand for the record, set the record straight so there's no problem. I stand with all of those that have raised an eyebrow, a question, as to Senator, United States Senator Chris Coons, not being in support of the vote that was needed for the president's appointee to the Civil Rights Commission. Now, my understanding was, and I could be wrong, was that the vote in the Senate or the committee, whichever, was to allow the nominee name to come to the floor to be discussed on the floor of the Senate for a possible vote. And that is my understanding, just finding it on TV and glancing through the newspaper and listening to some of the national networks and other people talking, that would have allowed the nominee's name to come before the full Senate. And that did not happen because it fell short of X amount of votes, of which one of those votes happened to have been our Delaware senator, United States Senator Chris Coons, our junior senator. And reading some of the articles and listening to the comment and some of the things that were said over the airwaves here, and just kind of paying attention from afar, if you will, because I've been very, very busy with Kingcenter and Housing Authority. I don't read the papers all the time. But from what I saw in paying attention and listening, I think that number one, I think that our good friend, the Reverend Dr. Sylvester Beeman, kind of hit the nail right on the head. His comment in the paper was something to the effect, not quote unquote, but Reverend Beeman said something about he was seriously concerned about why Senator Coons made the vote of the judgment the way he did. And, he wanted to know, talk with him, and hear more about that, because he, too, had a serious concern with the vote. Everybody that I've talked to and I hear talking about it has a serious concern with it. And I think that, as they think, Senator Coons made a bad vote. And those who think he didn't, or if he still thinks he didn't, then that's his right to do that. But I feel with those who say it was a bad vote. The Civil Rights Commission is one that must have an attorney of the greatest ability to be able to deal and represent, and the candidate represented or recommended by President Barack Obama to the Senate to be confirmed, happened to have been that candidate. But because of involvement with a client, as I understand, pro bono, that he didn't get paid for, was assigned by the court, as I hear the story. What bothers me is the fact that he would be not given an opportunity as of the vote that was cast going back a couple weeks ago. He would be denied that opportunity simply because of he represented one of which who was supposed to have shot and killed or whatever, a police officer or whatever, up in Philadelphia, I think it was. And as a result, the national FOP came out against his confirmation and his nomination, the national FOP. Well, first of all, I, like Senator Coons and many of you, I support our first responders, our police officers all over the country, as well as our veterans and our service people. They have an awesome, responsible job and a duty they do, and lay their lives on the line every day that they walk out of their house to go do their job. So I have the utmost respect for them, law enforcement officers. But the fact of the matter is that to state their case and make their opinion, the national FOP, that's one thing to be considered and looked at. But at the very bottom line, I believe that deep down in Senator Coons' heart, in retrospect, as he thinks back on this issue of the vote not to support, is one that perhaps regrets, perhaps wished that he had given more thought before the vote, and even had a talk with the FOP president or whoever, but from there voted to allow his conscience to be clear. Let me tell you something. Chris Coons, Senator Chris Coons, and I have always been friendly. We have never been close or good friends, as I consider good friends. But I respect him as a man, and I feel comfortable he respects me. But lay all that aside. The fact of the matter is, in my opinion, and knowing Chris Coons, to be the good godly person that he is, we disagreed on some of our politics, and perhaps we will. But that's something that doesn't come into play here, the politics of the situation. What comes into play is either to do the right thing or do something that you may regret that may cause a tremendous backlash that should not have been, had the right thing, the godly thing, been done in the first place. Senator Chris Coons, as I understand, has some preacher background or is a member of the clergy. I remember that. I think of that as I talk about him. And he's a fine person, a fine family man. He's a fine person. The bottom line is, I remember that my good friend, the Reverend Dr. Shelton Nix, was telling me about Chris had come over to his church one day and preached a sermon. So I'm pretty sure he's a pastor or very close to the scripture, if he's not a pastor. But he's a good and decent individual. That's how I see him, a good and decent individual. And let me just say this here, that, I'm friendly. We're not the best of friends. I'm friendly with the new state chairman of the Republican Party, Chai Copeland, who does a TV show here the first and third Sunday of each month, 9 to 10. Charlie and I are friendly and very respectful friends. Never been close, never hung out and drank a beer or drank a Coke or ate a sandwich together, but we're friendly. And I have a lot of people that I'm friendly with. My other Republican friend I'm very close to, and I cherish his friendship, and we are close. And that's that Republican that stirs up a whole lot of problems sometime on Crossfire. I don't think that's the name of it. That's Norman. I'm thinking about Charlie Potter. Straight talk. And I'm talking about our good friend of this community, the Reverend Calvin Brown. Calvin is a live wire. He's a very good friend, but he too is a Republican. And I don't hold that against him, although I wish he would come on over to the better side. Calvin, if you're sitting out there, love you, brother, love you. But let me just say that as it relates to the comment of our good friend and respected brother of the community, a Bethel Church leader, the Reverend Sylvester Beeman, and I agree with him. His comment was that he wasn't ready to turn away from Senator Coons. He wanted to hear more about it, and he was going to look at the good versus anything on the negative side. Makes sense to me. That's the way we should look at any candidate. Makes sense to me. The good should always outweigh the ugly or the bad decision that was made. And I feel that way about Chris Coons. I bring up Charlie Copeland, the Republican chairman, because Charlie, more particularly around election time, and you know we're going through now the 2014 election primary will be coming up in September and then the general election in November. So we're off into the election year 2014. And Charlie will have guests on, and Charlie will sit here over these airways and try to convince you, our viewers, people of color, why you should be looking more at the Republican candidates and helping to vote them in public office. And some of them are very good, very good. Tom Wagner, a good friend of mine, Republican auditor, been there for years. Mike Castle was good people. There are some good Republican candidates. Mike Castle no longer there. But the fact of the matter is, Charlie, going into election time, makes his pitch. He makes his pitch to try to get a lot of support for the Republican candidates that are running. And some of them are very good folk. But the bottom line is, I'm not ready as a lifelong Democrat and one who has a voice and leadership in this community and over these airways and a respectability of a lot of you on the other side of this camera and those that don't have cable. I'm not, because of a mistake of one of our Democratic brothers, and I'm talking about Senator Chris Coons right now. He or anyone else, because of a misjudgment that I hope he's going to have an opportunity to correct. And Norman told me this week that he was trying to get Senator Coons to come on his show. It may be tonight, 9 o'clock, on Crossfire. He may have Senator Coons coming on. But the point is, I'm not going to throw our Democratic brothers that are in office, white, black, whatever, I'm not going to throw them under the bus for a mistake that I may or you may disagree with them. I say, look at the good and weigh it on a scale. And I think you will find that they have been there many more times than not. With Chris and this vote and not supporting is a big one. It's a big one, no doubt. The Civil Rights Commission that deals discrimination against AIDS, sex, and employment and other things. It's a big one. And I hope they'll get it straightened out. I pray they will. I pray they will. But you have to understand, as we talk Democrat and Republican, just take a look at what President Barack Obama has tried to get done from his first and second term as president of this United States to represent all of the people of this United States in a fair and across the board way. National health care, quote unquote Obamacare, and a lot of other things. The Republican-controlled Congress has fought him every step, every inch of the way. We're going to make him a one-termer. We're not going to give him anything, even after he beat them overwhelmingly, gone in for re-election. Far more delegates. He needed 273 electoral votes. He got, I think it was 332. Way over what he needed. Won states that they knew they were going to beat him in. He won in Florida. With a Republican governor, he beat him. So all I'm saying is the Republican Party, and this being a what do we do about Chris Coons and the whole African-American community, let's turn on him and throw him out of office. I'm not ready to go there. And I don't feel you should be. And if I stand alone and I know I don't, then I'll stand alone when I feel I'm right, because I'm talking the good godly message. That's what I'm sharing with you here tonight. We don't throw out the baby with the bathwater, as they used to say. You don't throw out the baby with the bathwater. And when I, you know, to allow a situation where a Republican opponent could come up and run for Senate against Senator Chris Coons, and to create an opportunity because we're hung up in this, and I hope Chris gets an opportunity and can fix it. I'm here that it's going to come back some way before the Senate. The fact of the matter is, a Republican United States Senator that happens to win and beat our Democrat Senator Chris Coons, who's done a lot of good for us and people all over the country, but us here in Delaware, people of color. The bottom line is, that Republican, with your help, if you vote for that, that Republican senatorial candidate will have to go in and sit with the Republican Senate caucus and become a part of that caucus and want to be on committees and get things done. They're going to have to go along with that Republican caucus. Take a look at what's happening in the House right now. And it was Mitch McConnell, the leader of the Republican caucus, making the statement that we're going to make him a one-term president. The Republican side in the House fought national health care every step of the way, not trying to fix the problems of where they are well before time. They could have helped to fix it, but all they done was voted 46 times to appeal. Hope you understand my message. This is two-time talk, ready to sit with anybody on any of these shows that want to debate it or talk about it. That's the way I see it, and that's the way it ought to be. We need to stand by Chris, and Chris needs to fix it. Until next time, God bless.